Hello and welcome to this new video. The topic is Intellectual Revolution of the 6th Century BC. Meaning and significance of this. 6th Century BC was the century of the philosophical or intellectual speculation on the large scale. There are many teachers which moved around with their disciples in the form of Sraman or monks or sannyasis. They would involve with others in the philosophical speculation or discussion. The intellectual environment was known to be very open. The people would easily accept the good doctrines of the rivals. In such environment, the new ideas and thoughts did groom very well, and the people were pondering on the problems of world and life. One interesting aspect of this intellectual revolution was that many kshatriyas, many princes, after leading the life of luxury, would develop a tendency to become the monks or sannyasis. Buddha and Mahavir were two such stalwarts. According to the literary tradition, there were six greatest philosophers of the time. They were Puran Kashyap, who was an antinomian, which means that virtuous deeds have no effect on the people's karma or action. Makhali Ghoshal was basically a believer in the determinism of extreme kind. His religious order later on came to be known as Ajivik religion. He was a believer in the fatalism of extreme nature. It is very interesting that Makhali Ghoshal and Mahavir moved around as friends for 6 years, but later on the differences emerged between these two great personalities and they parted company. Ajit Kesh Kamlin was another great scholar. He was a materialistic philosopher. Pakud Kachayan was an atomist. Pakud Kachayan was the one who propounded the Vaisheshik system of philosophy. No doubt this system of philosophy is associated with the name of Kanad, but its propounder was at the basic level Pakud Kachayan. Nigant Nagpur was another scholar. Nigant Nagpur was another scholar. He was basically Mahavir Vardhaman. It was his acquired title Nigant and Nagpur. This is in Prakrit. Nigant means Nirgrant. Nagpur, that he was born in the Natrik clan, Gnatrikca. Natrik clan, that's why he was popularly known as Nigant Nagpur. So he was the founder of Jainism, or he was basically the promoter of the Jain tradition. As we know that Jain tradition was known to be based on Tirthankaras, he was better if we call him as the promoter of the tradition of the Tirthankaras, promoter of the Jain teachings. Sanjay Vilathiputta was another great philosopher of these six. He was an skeptic or agnostic. It means he held doubt in the existence of everything, perhaps. He claimed that there is no absolute knowledge. According to Sanjay, there was no absolute knowledge. Knowledge is related, and knowledge is based on so many parameters. Besides these six greatest philosophers, interesting fact is that Lord Buddha's name is not included in these six greatest philosophers of time. We don't know anything regarding that, but Buddha and Mahavir were the two great scholars, philosophers, whose religious formats continued to benefit the people over the generations, over the ages, and even now these two religions persist. Now we will take into the factors and forces which helped Buddha and Mahavir in laying the foundation and in carrying forward their ideologies, which benefit the mankind even to this day. It is very interesting that Buddha and Mahavir both belonged to the republican background. They had been the princes. They got the idea of the republican bodies, and on this basis they set up their republican orders. Buddha set up Sangha and Mahavir set up Gana. This Gana was based on equality of caste and gender. Both the great personalities did not believe in caste-based discrimination or gender-based discrimination. Once a person got entry into the order, men or women, they were given equal access to the studies. They were not treated low. All were equal within the order. Organization of this institution known as Sangha or Gana was one of the most important reason of the success of Buddhism and Jainism. Both Buddha and Mahavir did have the attractive personalities. They had aura around themselves. They were working in a selfless manner for the welfare of the people, for the welfare of the society. That's why the people naturally attracted to these two great thinkers, scholars. Both had the command over the language. Both adopted Prakrit for communicating their knowledge, wisdom to the common people. And they would not lose their calm patience while educating the public about them. Now, the success of any religion, which depends on a number of variables, will definitely hinge around the usefulness or utility of the teaching. Ideology or the benefit which the people would draw out of all these. Buddha and Mahavir did flourish in a particular background where the Brahminical culture was blowing in full stream. The Vedic religion was filled with the rituals and sacrifices. These sacrifices used to be very costly. They also looked to the people, the dull and boring exercises. These were not successful in motivating the people, in including the people in the activities of religion. The nature of the Brahminical religion was itself a big factor in the success of Buddhism and Jainism. Many people felt non-inclusive in the process of religion. The boring and dull exercises of ritualism were quite complex. The Brahmins chanting the mantras, most people fail to understand their meaning and sense. The exercises also used to be costly. That's why most people would not be having the capacity to fulfill these costly exercises and to bear the cost of the Brahmins. At the same time, the Brahminical society was based on inequality and discrimination that had two grounds. It was the caste-based discrimination and the gender-based discrimination. Gender-based discrimination. Brahminical society was suffering due to this stigma against the women, against the Sudras. Both were included in the non-dwij. It means that they were not twice born, and they were not permitted the formal education. They were not included in the religious and other social activities. For them, performance of the rituals was useless. In that sense, we can say that the ritualism and the sacrificial mode of worship, which was very, very confusing to the people, general public, not only the general public, even the intellectuals from the later Vedic age, which composed the philosophical books, texts like Upanishads, they also didn't like all such type of ritualism. They themselves focused on making the format of religion simple. In this backdrop, when Buddha and Mahavir focused on making the religion transparent, making the religion open, inclusive, and simple, and understandable to the people, understandable to the common people, who had been fed up with these dull and boring rituals and sacrifices. In Mundak Upanishad, it is written that the rituals are just like performance. Rituals were just like the broken boats moving in the desert. It means it would take you nowhere. You can get any spiritual satisfaction. This ritualism had become dull, boring, and monotonous. This had made the religious format non-inclusive. This was not liked by the people, not only the common people, but also the well-placed people. It's very interesting that two religions, Buddha and Mahavir's religions, they were supported by all the sections of the society. So we can say that the opposition to the Brahminical form of worship, form of ritualism, was genuine in one or the other sense. It involved the killing of the large number of the animals. Cattle wealth was being decimated for no use of that. At a time when agriculture was growing, when agriculture was in the expansion mode, many people were busy in expanding into the new areas, and they were involved in the cutting and felling the trees and bring those areas under cultivation. It is in that sense that Buddha would say that cattle were the giver of grain, giver of beauty, and giver of happiness. It means he emphasized on the preservation of the cattle wealth. And similar was the teaching of Mahavir. They captivated the imagination of the cattle rearers, the agriculturists, bankers. Cattle rearing and agriculture were promoted in harmony, and they are quite interdependent exercises at the local level. Another reason behind the rise and growth of Buddhism and Jainism was that Buddhism and Jainism believed in the earned status. Earned status means earned status in the society. It means that whatever you contribute to the growth of the society and economy, your status should be based on that. Your contribution should be the basis of your position in the society. But contrary to Buddhism and Jainism, in the Brahminical system, the born status or caste was more important. Caste was more meaningful. Mahavir and Buddha focused on Arana status, while the Brahmanical scholars focused on the born status. So Buddha and Mahavir, out of this egalitarianism, they organized an order, Sangha or Gana, where the cardinal principle was equality of all the men and women which entered this order. Everything in that order or the Sangha organization or institution was determined, decided on the basis of the contribution of the entrants into that. In that sense, the big battle was won by Buddha and Mahavir on this ground, that they drew towards themselves the members of different Varnas. No doubt Buddha and Mahavir believed in the Varna system, fourfold Varna system, but they did also believe that Varna should not be based on birth. Varna status should not be based on birth. Varna status should be based rather on karma or the deeds or the contribution. Herein lies the big success scored by Buddha and Mahavir on the prevailing Brahmanical or Vedic format of religion and society. Another aspect of the success of Mahavir and Buddha was that Buddha and Mahavir catered to the needs of the different segments of the society. They improved and promoted the dynamics of the social change as well as economic change. They accepted whatever had happened in the society and economy. They accepted the value of importance of the people, new classes which had appeared in the society as a result of the social and economic development process. That's why these people who were the traders and bankers and who were organizers of the new kind of economy, they were given free hand, they were given full freedom to operate their trading and banking operations and move around in all the directions from Takshala to Bengal. And they were the people which were known as the Srishtis or the traders. They were the real promoter of the wealth and trade to the society. The urbanization process was also the integral part of this process of the social and economic changes. Social and economic changes, as this age, 6th century BC, is associated with the rise and growth of the large number of the urban centers associated with the trade routes. So, in this context, we need to understand the Brahmanical literature. Brahmanical literature, that is known as the Sutra literature in the form of Dharma Sutras, is revealing in itself. A great Brahmanical scholar known as Bodhayan says that people should not move into the lands of Magad, Ang, Vang, etc. These were the apavan lands or impure lands. These lands were called as the impure land, impure or apavan lands. Bodhayan also says that the people should not deal in this business, in this trade, in this article. There were many ifs and buts, there were many restrictions put on the trading and banking operations. Banking was not deemed permissible in the Brahmanical literature or the Sutra literature. Herein lies the importance of Buddha and Mahavir. And this should be understood, that they provided the bankers and traders of the time the full freedom to move around in different directions, in the operation of their trade and business. They provided them full freedom in the banking, etc. The common rate of interest was 20% per annum. Banking business flourished, trading also flourished, and these contributors to the trade and banking and other economic operations were the new class, which didn't get any recognition in the Brahmanika literature or the Vedic literature. Along with this growing trade and commerce, the dichotomy between the Brahmanika literature and the Buddhist and Jain viewpoint, Buddhist and Jain viewpoint is very much visible. In Bodhayan literature, sutras, it is clearly said that don't go to the cities, don't take abode in the cities. Cities are filled with smoke and dust, and if you go there, you will likely lose your caste or status. In contradiction to this view, or opposed to this view, we have the opinion of Buddha and Mahavir, which claim that the urban centers were the centers of progress. The urban centers were the centers where the progressive people take abode, and the people were given the full freedom to move around, including the urban centers. Urban classes were given the recognition by Buddha and Mahavir. Buddha and Mahavir both took their resting time in the urban centers. Buddha rested most in Sravasti, which was the capital of the Kosal Janpad. Here we come to know one important dichotomy between Buddha and Mahavir on the one hand, and the prevailing intellectual system of Brahmanical people, that Brahmanical people would impose a number of restrictions on the people's movements. Brahmanical scholars made the life of the people clumsy and monotonous, dull and boring. They had made the life of the people non-inclusive, that they had no feeling of satisfaction from the prevailing intellectual and religious format. In that sense, when we know that both of these people, both of these thinkers, they organized their order on the basis of equality, on the basis of harmony, goodwill, this was sufficient to attract a large number of the people from all the walks of life. They were the great genius people. They were dynamic in their approach. They gave approval to all what had happened in the society. Their success lies in the fact that whatever had happened in the society and in the economy, they provided the approval to all that social and economic development. Not only this, they also gave approval to the higher taxation collected by the kings of Magadh. They were basically the dynamic and resilient scholars. They had the idea of the pulse of the people. That's why they were successful in taking the sails out of the mills of the prevailing religious and social format of the Brahmanical system. The fact is that if your ideology, if your doctrine is instrumental in making the life of the people easier, open, transparent, then the people would automatically, readily would accept that on the ground of the utility, usefulness of that doctrine, that it made the life of the people easy, it made them inclusive in the entire system of religion, and it also gave them the relief from the heavy expenditure. It also helped in their economic operations, and at a time when Buddha and Mahavir were successful in organizing their format of institution, definitely they created a big space for themselves in the 6th century BC. Not only the 6th century BC, but their religions continue even to this day, because these religions were based upon the commonsensical understanding. They were easy to understand. They were based upon the harmony and balance in the society, good thinking, good living, and ethics, principles of behavior in the society. Means nothing else to be done for getting the religious merit. That's why they were successful. In all, we can say that it is not very unusual. We say that it is not very unusual that in the situation of the 6th century BC, Buddha and Mahavir were successful in transmitting their legacy over to the people, and it continues for generations, continues for the ages. It means that they were not suitable. They were not suitable to the social and economic format of the 6th century BC. But whatever the ideology they inculcated, so it inspired confidence among the people, and through the ages, the people got attracted and keep attracted towards this ideology. Because there are so many points of positivity, creativity in this ideology, which believes in principles of good behavior, good attitude, good thinking, good memory. They focus on all these things which are useful for the format of the society. That's why they were successful. Thank you very much. Your comments are welcome, and we would be uploading such type of videos for the benefit of the civil services aspirants. Thank you very much.